All right, if you have your Bible this morning, we are going to be in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 14. And we're going to look at a couple of different New Testament passages this morning to kind of unpack this story that we're going to look at. You saw the bumper video there. We're going to be over the next 4 weeks talking about lessons from the water, stories from the water, looking at these specific times that Jesus taught from the setting where water was involved. And from those stories, a lot of those have just some really great and deep truths there. We wanted this series to be a partner series for our Champ Camp, which has all about to do with the water called Making Waves. And I've read over a lot of the curriculum that they're going to be used. It's going to be beautiful because the kids are going to learn about God the Creator. They're going to learn about Jesus the Savior. And then on Tuesday night, they're going to learn from Galatians about the Holy Spirit, how He's the sustainer of their life. And so over these three nights, they're going to hear the gospel, but they're also going to hear as much of a complete picture of the gospel story as we can do in three nights. And so I hope this series will be an encouragement to you. So when you think about Jesus and you read stories from the New Testament, especially these stories where He's teaching, we quickly realize and understand that He is the master teacher, He's the greatest preacher that ever lived, and His truth was life-changing. He was teaching from Himself or from His own truth. And as we read through the New Testament, especially in the Gospels, where we'll spend a lot of time over the next few weeks, we see these stories of Him teaching and healing and serving people. And so Jesus often used the water as a background for His teaching. Some Bible experts believe that part of the reason for that was not just because there was, during the time that they lived, there were a lot of water available, but also because of the acoustics, where Jesus' voice could travel better when water was around. And so you find a lot of these stories around water. And before we open this text, and I always try to do this in the message, and I've told you this before because it helps my understanding of the story is, when I begin to unpack a biblical text, one of the first questions that I'm asking myself as far as in understanding the text is, where is the tension here? Like, where's the tension in my life based on the text? Not only is, you know, we're looking for what does it mean to the original audience and what's going on at the time that it was written, but what is the tension here when I read this and then I get to the point in that process where I'm thinking about my own life and the culture, the times that we live, and for the church, you know, where do we see that tension? And I think in this story, it's unique because this is a story about storms. And it's a story about Jesus engaging the disciples in a time of storms. And I think the tension for most of us is when we feel like we're about to be in a storm, a time where we're going to be tested, or we feel like one's coming, or maybe we find ourselves in one, our initial reaction at times is, where is the way out of this? Where is my way of escape? How long is this going to last? What things can I do right now in my life to step out of this storm that I'm in or that I'm about to be in? And a storm could be a situation that we're dealing with personally in our own lives, but it could also be a situation that's happening in the lives of someone else. When someone close to us or someone that we love is going through a storm, that storm kind of becomes our storm. And so as we see a storm approaching at times in our life, we think, I need to find the quickest way out of this. Is there a way around this storm? But I want to leave us, as we start this text, with this tension because it helped me understand it. What if the storms in our lives are the very things that God will use to unite us closer to Him and the things that He will use to move us toward greater spiritual maturity? What if we need the storms? What if the real experience of Jesus for a follower of Christ is in the storm? What if that's where we grow the most? What if the storms are the very place where we're sharpened and we grow and maturity happens in our lives spiritually? What if it's in the storms that we unite with God in a more near and close way? And if that's true, then we need to find ways to embrace the storms that come our way and really find the way to experience Jesus in the storms rather than trying to avoid them. This is a passage in Matthew chapter 14, and I'm going to read verses 22 through 33, and we'll look at another account of this in the Gospel of John, but let's start here. Matthew 14, starting in verse 22. And you've likely heard this story before. We'll kind of unpack some of what it means. It says, immediately he made the disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. This is Jesus they're talking about. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But the boat by this time was a long way from the land, beaten by the waves, for the wind was against them. And in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, "It's a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." And Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And he said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat and he walked on the water and came to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." And Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took hold of him, saying to him, "O you of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." To help us understand this passage, I want you to go quickly to John chapter 6, in verses 14 and 15, and listen to what it says. It says, "When the people saw the sign that he had done, they said, 'This is indeed the prophet who is to come into the world.' Perceiving then that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, Jesus withdrew again to the mountain by himself." And so those two verses are John's account of what happened. So when we see at the beginning of the text we read in Matthew, where it says immediately he made the disciples get into the boat, John tells us why when he accounts and writes about this story. You see, when they saw the miracle that Jesus had just done, which is a feeding of 5,000 people that precedes the story of him walking on the water, the people saw this. And you have to remember, this was a very hostile political climate that was going on during this time. And what the people wanted was not so much a savior or a spiritual redeemer. They wanted an earthly king. They wanted somebody that would overthrow the government that they felt was oppressing them. And so when they saw Jesus, and this happened a number of times, when they saw Jesus do this feed these 5,000 people just a little bit of food, and they saw that it was a physical miracle, they said, "This is the guy. This is the one that's going to set us free. This is the one that's going to be our earthly king. This is the one that's going to overthrow all this oppression that we've faced." And so much so that they were willing to do whatever means possible, the scripture helps us understand. So when John writes that Jesus perceived that they were about to take him by force, this is why he sends the disciples immediately away. Because you have to remember, at this point in the story, the disciples had not been with Jesus very long. And the text doesn't tell us, and I don't know if it was Jesus was worried that maybe they would be physically harmed, or maybe Jesus was worried that they weren't close enough to him or deep enough in their spiritual lives where they wouldn't become a part of this earthly political revolution. But whatever the case, when Jesus begins to perceive that the people were restless and they wanted to take him by force to be their earthly political king, he immediately sends the disciples away to get into the boat. And so when we read that at the beginning of Matthew 22, that's the context that's going on. And so what we see is Jesus sends them away. They get in the boat and they start their journey. Jesus tells them he's going to meet them a little while later. And then he goes to be with the Father. And I didn't put much about this in the text this morning, but it's always a great reminder is that most of the time, I can't say every time in the New Testament, but most every time when we see a story where Jesus pours himself out in teaching or feeding or miracles, the next passage often says he immediately went back to be with the Father. This is a great learning point for us in our spiritual lives. We spent the last two messages talking about living a Sabbath life, having Sabbath rhythms in our lives. But Jesus always spent time with the Father to fill up before he would empty himself out in his teaching, in his preaching, in his healing. And we know that he was deity, but he always found himself back with the Father. So he spends most of the night after this in prayer. And so we see in this passage that once Jesus is done praying, he's going to go back and join the disciples. But the Matthew text tells us that the boat is already a long way from the land and that a storm has come. But John, again, adds another detail that Matthew didn't include in his account of this story. Look in John 6 again in verse 16. It says this: "When evening came, his disciples went down to the sea, got into a boat, and started across the sea to Capernaum." It was now dark, and Jesus has not yet come to them. Matthew tells us this, but listen to this detail that John gives us. The sea became rough because a strong wind was blowing. And when they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near their boat, and they were frightened. So this, when we read the story of Jesus walking on the water, this isn't that the boat was a little bit offshore. No, Jesus had just done a 5K in a storm on the way to the boat, right? I walked 4 miles this morning and almost didn't make it back to my house, and it was on dry land, and I knew a lot of the neighbors. So you can imagine the disciples, right? That it's a storm. And again, we know that a lot of these guys were fishermen, so they were familiar with the sea and with boats. And so for them to be afraid, we know that this is a storm that's significant. It's raging. And so they've been out a lot of the night rowing and fighting this storm. And all of a sudden they see this figure and they know they're 3 or 4 miles offshore, and they see Jesus walking towards them. We see a reference in Matthew's account to fourth watch. This was a reference to Roman military time. And in Roman military time, the time from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m., they would break that up into four different watches of 3 hours. And so when you read fourth watch, that means that it was likely between 3 and 6 a.m. that they see Jesus walking on the water, which means that this lets us know that it had been a long night for the disciples and that Jesus had spent much of the night after this feeding in prayer. He'd spent hours and hours and hours alone with the Father. And then he decides he's going to go meet up with his friends, the disciples. But in true Jesus form, like we see him in other stories, he's always teaching a lesson. And even his method of choosing to meet up with them was a way that Jesus was teaching them more about who he was a way of teaching them a little bit more about what they needed to know about who Jesus was. He certainly could have met them on the other side, but Jesus decides to meet them 3 or 4 miles in the middle of the sea in the midst of a great storm. And so the disciples, who apparently had stopped looking for Jesus to meet them, or simply did not cross their minds that this is where they were going to meet up in the middle of this sea, they believe they've seen a ghost, and they start freaking out like they always do. And of course, we always see this in Scripture. When somebody freaks out, the person usually says, "Have no fear." Like, that's what the angels did at the resurrection, right? We're freaking out, have no fear. That's always good. If you're freaking out, all you need is for somebody to say, "Have no fear," then everything gets better. But in this case, it's Jesus, right? And so Jesus immediately identifies himself to them. And although they realize now that it is Jesus, they are no less freaked out about what they've just seen and what they just saw and what they are now experiencing. And they're trying to wrap their mind around how Jesus did this. They just didn't do this miracle, but now he's doing this, and he's met us in the middle of this sea, in the middle of this storm, and he's telling us not to be afraid. And it's at this point in the story that everything kind of shifts to this last couple of verses, this encounter that Peter and Jesus have. And so Peter, essentially, he challenges Jesus with a question about who he really was. And this is essentially what Peter is asking Jesus. He says, "Jesus, if this is really you, really walking on this sea in the middle of this storm, then command me to walk on this storm, on this water, and come to you." Because you have to remember, the disciples are still at the point in their relationship with Jesus. They're trying to figure out if he is who he says he was. Is he really who we think he might be? Is he really who he's starting to tell people that he is? Is he really the Son of Man? Is he really the Son of God? Is he really the Redeemer that we've waited for? And so with this question where Peter says, "If it's really you, then you tell me to come walk to where you are." That's what he's essentially asking. "Jesus, are you who you say you are? And if you are, then help me walk to you. Help me walk on water." And so with that statement, Peter's trying to figure out with Jesus, "Are you who you say you are? And can you do what you say you can do?" And I think this is a question that a lot of us have to wrestle with at some point in our lives. When it comes to our salvation, when it comes to our faith, when it comes to understanding who God is, we have to ask these questions. Is Jesus really who the Scriptures say that he is? Did he really do what the Scriptures and history say that he did? And so Peter wanted to know if it was true. Are you really the Messiah? Are you really the Son of God? And are you really the Savior and Redeemer that's come? And if you are, then you tell me to walk to you. And so Jesus answers that question with one word, and he tells Peter, "Come." He's saying, come to me, Peter, and see for yourself. Peter, come and experience me in this storm. Come walk on this ocean with me and see that I am who I say I am. And Jesus had used this method before with other people. If you remember Thomas, who when Jesus wasn't there and the disciples were reporting that they had seen Jesus, you remember what Thomas said in John, that's recorded in John chapter 20. Thomas says, unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails, and I place my finger into the mark of the nails and place my hand to his side, I will never believe. And so it wasn't long after that. Obviously, Jesus knows where Thomas was in his belief or in his struggle. He answers that question. Same chapter, verse 26, it says, 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. And although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them, and he said, peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe. And Jesus is always taking these moments where these disciples are struggling. Is he really who he says he is? And what does he invite them to do? To experience him. Come experience me. Come follow me. That was his original invitation. Come follow me. Come spend time with me. Come walk with me. Come experience who I am, and you'll see that I am who I say I am. And so we know what happens in the rest of the story, right? Peter takes his eyes off Jesus, and man, bad things start to happen, right? He begins to sink into the sea, and so he immediately calls out to Jesus. Jesus rescues him. They both get back in the boat. And as the story kind of wraps up, there's really two responses that happen. One is the response between Jesus and Peter about what just happened. And the other response is what happens to the disciples who were in the boat seeing all of this take place with Jesus and Peter. And so first, the response about Peter, he had to face this piercing question from Jesus as they were getting back into the boat, where Jesus says, you have little faith, why did you doubt? Why did you doubt? Peter, you were in this storm. And then you asked for this other part. You asked to come where I was. You asked for a greater level of trust. You asked to come experience in me, and I showed you who I was. And you still doubted. You still struggled. Why did you doubt? And I think what's interesting about this question is how Jesus asked it, because he keeps it about that very moment. Because you have to know Jesus knew how Peter was, right? And we know later on that Peter's the guy that, man, he'll just say it. And he has other moments like this where he struggles. And we know that he's the one that denied Jesus after the crucifixion. So Jesus didn't deal with all that. He dealt with just this moment. He didn't say, Peter, why do you doubt? But Peter, why did you doubt? In this moment, when you asked to come to me and I helped you walk on water to show you who I was, why did you doubt? Why is your faith so small? Peter, why is it that in this experience where you're in the midst of a raging sea, fearing for your life, you see me walking towards you, and then I call you to myself, and despite of all that stuff, you can't keep your eyes on me long enough. You don't have enough faith just for this moment. Peter, why did you doubt? And so Peter has to face that question from Jesus. So I want you to think about some of the storms in your life. I want you to think about some of the things that have been an opportunity for you to walk through some difficult times, to walk through some difficult moments. And I wonder if you and I are not like Peter a lot of times. And man, we take our eyes off Jesus and we start thinking about ourselves and thinking about this storm and wishing we were out of it. And why is this happening to us? And why this and why that? And I wonder if in our hearts, by way of the Holy Spirit, we're not getting the same question from Jesus as, why did you doubt? Why did you doubt? And so now we have the other response from the others in the boat. Verse 33 in Matthew's passage says, and those in the boat worshiped him, saying, truly you are the Son of God. And this response shows us not only that the disciples are beginning to understand a little bit more about Jesus, but it also shows us that they're growing. Because there's another story of Jesus and the disciples and a boat out on the sea in Matthew chapter 8. And here's what it says. It says, and when he got into the boat, his disciples followed him. And behold, there arose a great storm on the sea, so that the boat was being swamped by the waves. But he was asleep, talking about Jesus. And they went and woke him up saying, "Save us, Lord, we're perishing." And he said to them, "Why are you afraid?" Listen to what he says. "Oh, you of little faith." Then he rose, rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. And the men marveled, saying, "What sort of man is this that even the winds and the sea obey him?" So this is the second time the disciples have been freaked out in a storm. The first time Jesus was with them, he just was taking a nap during the storm. The second time he shows up walking across the sea in the storm. But notice how the disciples have grown in their reaction. In Matthew chapter 8, early in the ministry and the life of Jesus and the disciples, they see him have power over the sea. They see him calm the storms, rebuke the waves, and his very voice, everything becomes calm. And their response is, "Who's this guy?" Right? "Who is this guy that even the wind and the seas obey him?" Like, we've never seen anybody like this. And from Matthew 8 to Matthew 22, their response to seeing Jesus have power over the storm has moved from, "Man, who's this guy?" to, "Truly, truly you are the Son of God." And they'd seen a lot in those few chapters as Matthew records. They'd seen healings and teachings and feedings. And so we see that they're growing. And it's a beautiful story in both of them, I think, of a master who will go to great lengths to reveal himself to those he loves. One of the things I think it's worth considering for us is this concept of, in our lives, if you're going through a storm, or if I'm going through a storm, do you know it might be the most loving thing that Jesus could do for us is to allow us to go through a storm to reveal more of himself to us? It doesn't always feel like that, does it? When we're going through stuff in our life that's painful, that's hurtful, that causes us to just live with these immense amounts of grief, depending on whatever the storm is. But have you ever thought about that might be the most loving thing God could do for us? Meaning, I love you so much, and I want you so much to know me. I want you so much to see who I am. I want you so much to have this experience that the disciples did where we say, "Truly, you are the Son of God. Truly, you are good, and truly, you are loving." And it might be the most loving thing God can do is to allow us to go through a storm so that he can show us more of who he is. And I think when you and I begin to see storms like that, it changes our perspective on who God is. I wanted to give you a couple things to write down before we wrap up this message that I think will help us. Here's the first one. Jesus will use storms in our lives to remind us that he is Lord. You know, sometimes storms we go through are the result of choices that we've made. But not always. Not always. Sometimes they are. But storms are often from the Lord so that he could do the work necessary in our lives to show us more of who he is, to reveal more of his character, to reveal more of his goodness, to reveal more of those things to us. And he will use those storms in our lives to show us, to get our attention, to show us more of who he is. You know, in the Bible, it talks about two different kinds of storms. And I think this is important. This was helpful to me. One is the storm of correction. This is a storm that God uses to discipline us. These are often storms that we find ourselves in based on our choices, right? A storm of correction. The easiest, probably best example of this, the one you probably already thought of, is the life of Jonah. Jonah goes through a storm, a weird one, in Jonah in the four chapters of that book. But it's because he was disobedient. And God used that storm in his life to bring correction and discipline to Jonah because he was a follower of God. But Jonah grew from his storm. And he chose finally to obey God's call. And if you read chapter 1 and then read chapter 4, you see a different guy. A guy that goes through a storm and then realizes that God's trying to show me something. He's trying to teach me more about his love. And so Jonah finds himself in a storm of correction, one that he was in because of his choices. But God's going to use that in his life to show more of him. That's one storm. But the Bible also talks about a different kind of storm, the kind that we're reading about, and that's a storm of perfection. And these are storms that God uses in our lives to help us grow. These are storms that we walk through that a lot of times don't have anything to do with choices we made. Stuff just happens. We live in a fallen and broken world. Genesis 3 talks about that. We live in a world that's wrecked and ravaged because of sin, entered the human race, and stuff just happens. Church, every single week, I hear of something in somebody's life, a diagnosis, family issues, hurt, pain, grief, every single week. And these are often these storms of perfection, a storm that God allows us to go through so that he can help us grow. And that's what we see he's doing in the life of the disciples. Man, they're following Jesus. They're trying to know more. They've just been a part of seeing this incredible miracle. And then they just take off to sea to travel for a day, probably get some rest and have another day with Jesus of ministry. But Jesus allows them to go through this storm that he's going to use to grow them. He's helping them see him in greater and more beautiful ways. Do you think the disciples' view of Jesus changed after this? I certainly do. Do you think they were thinking more about maybe he really is who he says he is after this storm? I do. In fact, we've already seen how their response changes from the first storm they go through with him to the second one. That they move from guys that are like, man, who's this guy? Like, what kind of guy could do this kind of stuff? To maybe, truly, this is the Son of God. Maybe we are following the Messiah. Maybe we are following the one sent from God. Maybe we are following the Redeemer. And Jesus uses this storm to help them grow. So as we look back over our lives, have we been through these storms? We don't have to take a time, and we don't want to pass the mic, right? But we've been through storms of correction. We've been through storms in our lives where, because of our choices, man, we had to deal with the consequences of that. But that doesn't mean in storms of correction that God was nowhere to be found. He was probably using that storm to help us know him more, to help us grow, to help us grow in wisdom, to help him see his character, to help him see his grace. Listen, I could spend the whole month of messages talking about storms that I went through in my life because of stupid stuff that I've done, right? Stupid choices that I've made that I find myself in a storm. And I'm like, man, how'd I get here? Oh, yeah, I was disobedient. Or, oh, yeah, oh, you have little faith. Oh, yeah, I doubted the promises and the sovereignty of God. But I bet we can also look back over our life and remember those storms of perfection where, man, we don't know where they came from. But out of nowhere, we're going through, man, a diagnosis or a family issue or a struggle with our kids or a struggle in our marriage or a struggle at work. But what if our perspective on those times that, man, I'm so excited that I've got an opportunity to draw nearer to God in these moments because he's allowing these storms in my life. You know, the catalyst for growth in those storms is to have faith. And faith is this beautiful marriage of trust and hope. Right? That's what faith really is. It's this blending of trust and hope. And when you look at what Peter did, if we use him for an example, trust in his faith, trust is like taking that first step out of the boat. Like, I'm trusting you, Jesus. You're telling me to come to you. Like, I'm trusting you. Like, I don't have the skills necessary to walk on water, by the way. You're the only guy that can do this. But I'm trusting you. But what hope is in our faith is it's all the other steps. Like, Jesus, your promises were true here, so I'm taking another step of faith and another and another and another. And oftentimes in our life, in those moments, those big moments where we have to step out of the boat kind of moments, right? That first step is, God, I'm going to trust you. Your promises are true, I'm going to trust you. But all the steps of faith after that are steps of hope. I'm hoping in a Savior. I'm hoping in the promises of God, and we see that. And so living in faith in those storms is just this great balance of, God, help me to walk in trust and hope. But we know what the great adversary of faith is. It's doubt, right? And this is one of the greatest tools of the enemy. Doubt causes us to sink in the middle of the storms. Doubt causes us to really wonder if God's promises are true. Doubt causes us to take our eyes off Jesus. And doubt's one of the greatest tools that the enemy has used throughout Scripture and in our lives to lead us away from our faith. You remember back to the story in Genesis chapter 3 with Adam and Eve and the statement that the serpent, who we know from later in the scriptures is the devil himself, his statement was, did God really say that? Did he really say that? Did he really say you couldn't eat from this tree? Why would he say that? And how many times in our life has doubt crept in? Did God really promise you that? And so many times we find ourselves in a storm of correction because of our choices, or a storm of perfection where God's doing something great in our lives or he wants to. And man, these little seeds of doubt creep in, don't they? Do you really think God can bring you through this? Do you really think God's going to step into your finances? Do you really think God's going to step into your marriage? Do you really think God could help your... And when doubt steps in, it calls us to take our eyes off Jesus and we begin to sink. So as we're in those storms, remember this truth that Jesus will go to great lengths to calm the fears in our lives. He'll go to great lengths to calm those fears that we have. He wants you to have faith during your doubt. He wants your storms and my storms to be seasons of growth and times of maturity. And he wants our story to grow as we encounter him through the storms. He wants us to come through these storms with faith and trust and hope so that as we're around people, we'll likely find ourselves with someone in our lives about to go through a storm that we've gone through with Jesus. And man, we then have a testimony of the faithfulness of God. Here's the last thing. The very thing we fear is often the very thing that Jesus uses to come near to us. The very thing that we fear is often the very thing that Jesus wants to use to come near to us. See, in this story, the disciples' greatest fear was facing this storm without Jesus. That was their greatest fear. But Jesus was using the storm to draw near to his disciples, the thing they feared the most. Think about this in your life and my life. These things or scenarios or situations in our lives that we fear the most, these storms that we fear, these are often the very things that Jesus will use in our lives to draw us closer to himself, to show us more of who he is, to reveal more aspects of his character to us. This same storm that paralyzed the disciples with fear was the same storm that just moments later led them to say, "Truly, you are the Son of God." This thing that we were so scared about, Jesus, is the very thing you use to show us who you are. And church, listen to me. The things that happen in our lives, the storms that we walk through, those are the very things that I promise you we will look back. If we're faithful, we'll look back and say, that thing scared me so bad in my life, but it helped me see Jesus. It helped me see that he's real. It helped me see that he's good. It helped me see that he's true. It helped me see that he's loving. And it helped me see that he's sovereign over all things. And the very thing that our immediate reaction often is to avoid this, I promise you, that's the very thing God's going to use to make his way closer to you. Just some stories from our church. For some, it was a cancer diagnosis when the test came back. And the greatest fear was realized. Yet on the other side of that, for so many of those, it was through that cancer that Jesus came closer than he'd ever been before to those who were suffering. There's stories from our church of a wayward child that had been prayed for a long time. And there'd been long seasons of fear for the child and wondering if this child will ever come back to the ways of the Lord. Yet God often used those seasons of fear to draw that mom and dad nearer to him and to rely on him more. It deepened their faith. For others, it's been financial struggles, job struggles, family struggles. Those are the things that happen in our lives that bring us the greatest fear, that paralyze us, that show up out of nowhere and leave us feeling like, what is happening to me? I feel like I'm seeing a ghost. But it's in those very things, if we will walk with Jesus, he'll draw nearer to us. And it's in our moments of great fear that Jesus is often walking towards us through our storm to make himself known to us. You see, Peter didn't just want to walk on water. He didn't just want to do some tricks for the boys in the boat. He wanted to see if Jesus was really the Son of God. Jesus, are you real? I need you to show me that you're real. I need you to show me over and over and over again during this storm. I want to know that you're real. I want to know that you're Jesus. To really see him and to really know him, Peter didn't choose to avoid the storm or to hide in the boat. He chooses to embrace the storm with the hope that he could experience Jesus in a greater way. What about you and me? What about us? Where's our faith? Are we willing to step out of the boat so that we can catch a glimpse, a closer glimpse of the glory of God? Are we hiding in these storms, hoping they'll go away, not doing anything to try to deepen our faith? Are we like Peter saying, God, you have brought me in this storm, and so I need you to show yourself to me. I need you to use these terrible circumstances, this grief in my life, this heartache, this hurt. God, use all those things and show me more of yourself. Show me more of your goodness and show me more of your glory. Are you and I willing to do that in our lives individually? Let me give you a real scenario. What about our church and our future? We've been in a season of rough waters since early in 2020. It's been a hard couple of years, right? And the pandemic affected our church like many others. We're a different church since then. In a lot of ways, we're a healthier church. And navigating through those things changed many things about how you and I should define success as a local church. And so now that we're on the other side of that pandemic, knock on wood, we are faced with an opportunity, right, to step out of the boat and display great faith. Here's an example. Our leadership team here, along with me, we've been praying and dreaming and meeting about our next steps in renovating those upper buildings on our campus to reach more kids and students for Christ. It's a big price tag project. And with their approval, we're going to take the next steps in the next couple of weeks. I'm going to meet with an architecture firm in town, and we're going to begin that first phase of kind of taking all of our dreams and prayers and meetings and putting them on paper so we can really see what this might look like. And that step, I think, is going to help us see more clearly how we could create a space that's conducive for gospel learning and reaching more kids, students, and families in our community. And I can't tell you the number of conversations I've had with people, and I feel so guilty and so embarrassed to say that there's been so many times I thought, I don't know how a church our size can take on a project like that. And I feel like as soon as it comes out of my mouth, I'm having this encounter like Peter did, where Jesus is saying, "Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt?" Because make no mistake, it's a task much bigger than us. If I showed you the spreadsheet, we'd all vomit here collectively together. Or we could step out of the boat, keep our eyes on Jesus, and just watch him do the miracle. That's what I'd rather do. I'd rather just keep my eyes on Jesus with you and just watch him do a miracle. It's been said, I'll close with this. It's been said that each of us is facing one of three scenarios in our lives. You've heard this. We're either heading into a storm, coming out of a storm, or in the middle of one. So where are you this morning? Are you in the middle of a storm? If you are, just know this. Jesus is with you. And you might be in the very place he wants you to be so that he can show you more of himself. So that he can reveal more of his character to you. He may not choose to calm your storm, but he will likely use that storm to bring you closer to him. So you can trust him more and have more hope and faith in who he is. Over the next three nights at Champ Camp, this is what our kids will be learning from John chapter 7. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. And each night they're going to learn something more about Jesus through stories on the water. They're going to learn that God's the creator, Jesus is the savior, and the Holy Spirit is the producer of fruit in our lives. And each night they're going to have an opportunity to surrender our lives to the wave maker, the creator, the one who is Lord over all things, including the storms. So what about us? Have you surrendered your life to Jesus this morning? Have you surrendered your life to the one who is the wave maker, the creator, the Lord of the storm, who's the one who can bring the storms to our life, but he also calm the storms with his very words? Have you given your life to that Jesus? The one who came, who truly is the Son of God, as the disciples begin to realize. Have you chosen to follow him so that you might be right with God, have a life of hope and peace, and as John 10:10 says, a life of abundance that he promised? Storms are coming in our lives, and they can be great experiences to teach us more about Jesus. My challenge to you this week is don't wait for the storm in your life to surrender to Jesus. Surrender your life to Jesus today. When your storm comes, just know he'll be closer to you than ever before. And the very storm that you and I try to avoid at times in our lives might be the very thing that God wants to use so that we will understand more about who he is. And give him your life today. I know that there's some on TV that you could watch will say that once you give your life to Jesus, storms don't come into your life anymore. Well, that's bull hockey because it's not in the scriptures. But I will tell you this, that when you give your life to Jesus, You can be guaranteed that more storms are coming, but you will never, ever, ever walk alone, ever. I'm asking to bow your heads and to close your eyes. We're going to pray. My challenge this morning as the band comes to lead us is that you simply respond to the promptings of Jesus this morning. There's a card close to you somewhere that's got some things on there. If you are ready to surrender your life to Jesus this morning, you can do that right where you are, asking God to forgive you of your sins, trusting and believing that he is who he says he is. And you can choose to follow him. The same thing he invited the disciples to do. You could follow Jesus. He'll forgive you of your sins. And the storms that happen in your life, you won't go through those storms alone anymore. Or maybe you're here and you say, McLean, I'm a follower of Jesus, but man, I have not been obedient to God during the storms of my life. I've tried to sidestep them. I've tried to do the things I can for them to be over quickly. And I've not allowed those storms to be that thing in my life that draws me closer to Jesus. I've put my spiritual disciplines to the side and I've just gritted my teeth and waited for them to be over. Maybe this morning God's speaking to your heart and you can just repent of those things and you can ask God to help you see him more clearly, be more obedient in the storms. Or maybe you're like me in a prayer that I prayed this morning, a courageous prayer. Is God, would you bring storms into my life if it'll help me see you more? God, if that's what it takes for me to know you in a deeper way, then God, I want to invite storms to my life. And if you're at a place and you're on your spiritual journey where you're ready to pray that bold of a prayer, then pray it with me. God, if it takes a storm in my life to show us more of who you are, then God, send the storms to our lives. I didn't write this down. I was thinking about it this morning with your heads bowed and your eyes closed. So I was thinking about the message this morning, praying as I walked around my neighborhood. I thought about this old song called Blessings, where it basically talks about, God, if it takes tears, if it takes heartache, if it takes those things in our lives to help us see you more, then God, help us to see those things as blessings. What if it takes trials? What if it takes pain? What if it takes grief? Then let our attitude be, God, if it does, then send them our way so that we can know you more. So God, in these moments, help us to see you more clearly. That's our prayer. We want to know you more. We want to see more of your glory. We just want a glimpse of your character. And God, if it means that we have to walk through storms to see you more clearly, God, we invite those into our lives. God, for those here, those watching online that have never surrendered their life to Jesus for salvation, Father, let today be their day. May they trust you fully and follow you. God, help us in these moments to be fully obedient to the promptings and the nudgings of the Holy Spirit of God in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.